So as you can probably see, I'm Agnius Mašiša. I'm also a technical evangelist, and currently I'm working more or less in Latvia. I'm also doing some things that's across Baltically, or right now also a bit more than in Lithuania. And I'm representing the group in Microsoft, which is developer experience. Internally we are called Geeks, and we are people who are working with companies like Microsoft partners, who are independent software vendors building their own products, like startups or big companies, and we are helping them, let's say, to build their products and make them, let's say, best, so that they can be successful, and through that also, I don't know, maybe use Microsoft services and so on, because our technological focus right now is more or less on cloud stuff, and also on Windows 10, which will come up in summer. But yeah, so today here I will speak about building the Internet of Things backend architecture, kind of what things you could consider regarding patterns which are there, also about some cool stuff you can use, let's say from Azure services to achieve that, and what we have done, and maybe some ideas, let's say, how you can, let's say, save a lot of time for yourself and just create solutions which adds value. So yeah, but unfortunately I will be not speaking about, let's say, the exact Internet of Things part, meaning the devices and other devices and stuff like that, so I will not touch so much there, but yeah, hopefully you will enjoy it. So, okay. Something like that. Okay, cool. So agenda today, in the beginning I will speak about what it is, and then I will go over, let's say, kind of architectural patterns, and then I will, let's say, show some things which are happening, but as I was noticed very lately about that I have to speak, I will be, let's say, more, let's say, on slide kind of demo things, less than, let's say, on practical hands-on stuff, and not to mess up. And then I will show about some things which are coming up and you can use and build better solutions on top of that. So, is Internet of Things a new thing? Actually, no. Some guys will tell you that it has been around like for a lot of time, and they are building very big, complex solutions which are achieving them. But what's changed during this time is that there's a lot of new and let's say free stuff coming out here. So let's say, meaning that there's a lot of these cheap sensors and so on, and now that everyone kind of us can do and build some things with these with the Internet of Things, let's say build sensors which send some data and etc. and so on. So it's a unicorn. So what's next is recently, so they were built, let's say, for big corporations, and let's say for more manufacturing needs and so on. But right now we can, let's say, build our own solutions, and we can also put a lot of data there, and we can get some meaningful, let's say, thinking stuff there, and so there's building a lot of interesting things. Regarding building these solutions, first thing which we need to control is that, let's say, we are building things which can, let's say, impact people's life and so, let's say, security and so on. For example, one of the, let's say, most interesting cases I heard here in the region is that a company built solution which tracks, let's say, people movements in shops, meaning that, for example, as we all have actually these kinds of devices, phones, and these devices are actually broadcasting in shops, they are searching for some Wi-Fi's, if we have not turned Wi-Fi off. And by that, actually, you can possibly, let's say, track movements of people with triangulation from data from internet access points, and even if you are not connecting to these devices. And then they built this solution which, let's say, gathered all, let's say, this information, and then they created, let's say, a map how people are moving around the shop. And using this data, let's say, can be, let's say, and it's kind of cool stuff to thing to build, and the process, all these things. But there's also a lot of, let's say, questions about privacy, about what kind of things is then are, let's say, leaving on to us and so on. Do they can track your identity and so on? And in Europe, we have laws to protect our identity. And that's why they need, let's say, to clean all, let's say, information which could be used as in the identification of information about users, let's say, after one day or after some hours, so that there is nothing left in the system. And but yeah, but they add a lot of value, let's say, for their customers. So this one, oh, nice, it started to work. So what are the things you can use, let's say, on cloud platforms for creating, let's say, these Internet of Things devices and applications? So as you can see, there's a lot of stuff. So first thing is we need somehow to gather data. And to do that, we can use event hubs, or service buses and so on, let's say for more devices and sensors and whatever. And then we can have also some, I don't know, different databases which we could integrate and so on. And I don't know, like Twitter, for example. And then we need to save them in some kind of storage. And then we need to do some analytics processing that, let's say, use some machine learning on top of that and learn more insights, which let's say in real time, and then send feedback back to these devices so that we can do something and change its behavior or notify some other people that something is happening. Another one is, let's say, processing these streams in high speed, because when we are building, let's say, Internet of Things solutions, first when we are building them, let's say, in our garage, we are creating it, let's say, one device or three devices, which gives us, let's say, X amount of data, but then when we build let's say, bigger solution, which we have done testing and deploying into market, we can get up to number when we have, let's say, hundreds or thousands of these devices out there, and how we deal with that, and hope to reprocess them there, and so on. And then there is also a lot of, let's say, different places where you can show to your users, or let's say, to send back to your devices information what users can do or what let's say, these devices can influence. So regarding creating things, so as I said, we start with small things, and the first things usually we can do is that we build these prototypes for us, but when we are building, let's say, backend systems, we try to build them so that they will potentially scale if we want. And we want to build these scalable architectural things, let's say, fast, in terms that we don't need to waste time, because so that means usually that you need to use what you already know, or and if you, let's say, don't know how to build scalable things, then maybe you could use some, let's say, solutions which are built by others and so on. So let's say build, let's say, a mashup of other things. And also it's hard to predict things which actually make sense for you to collect and process. Because when you are building, let's say, these telemetry solutions or whatever, you don't know which of these readings will show you some insights which could, let's say, help you in them better. Because when you get, let's say, a lot of data, let's say you have, I don't know, some health sensor or whatever, and then it tracks 10 things, your heart rate, your blood pressure, I don't know, some your temperature, etc., etc. You don't know actually, in the beginning maybe, which combinations will give you what kind of results and what kind of knowledge about your users and so on. And yeah, and in the beginning it's also a lot easier, let's say, to test and deploy these solutions in smaller scales. So what we need to do is, as we actually are having, we have really low barriers to enter, then we need to, let's say, do some analysis on data we gathered. We can do that, or, I don't know, in the beginning we can also try to do that, I don't know, in some kind of analytics tool. You are using, I would say, Excel, because it's, let's say, the most easiest and convenient analytics tool we have. Or if you're using more advanced stuff, then you can also use, let's say, more advanced things to do that. Another thing is when you're building solutions, we start with telemetry, meaning that we collect also sensory data, but we don't do commands, meaning that we don't change, let's say, behavior of our solutions. We can add that later on when, when we already have learned some things about, let's say, our solution and the problem it solves more, let's say, so that we are more rapid in these things. All these learnings are actually coming from Microsoft. We had this huge team in Redmond, which is a technical working group, where they are spending, let's say, kind of a lot of time just, let's say, coming together and building some and trying out some new things. And there are four, let's say, groups who are doing that. One is for Internet of Things, one is for machine learning, and there are some other two as well. So, and the telemetry, how we can do that is we first get data, let's say, from our devices through some HTTP, and let's say they connect to web service endpoints, kind of. Then they are processed real-time with stream analytics, and then they are stored in whatever kind of storage, and you can then process them and let's say get some through analytics. You can write some queries and see what kind of data you are getting and what it indicates to you. So, and these let's say things which could help you to build architecture which are built by Microsoft, they're actually supporting all, let's say, a lot of known let's say contracts of negotiation, like first is the HTTP, which we probably everyone knows, MQP. I guess everyone who has worked with service buses or queues know what MQP is. Yeah?
No.
No? Yes, okay. So it's a standard, let's say, for sending, let's say, these messages for queues or whatever, and you could, for example, right now the most popular solution in market you can use to, let's say, which is free, you can use this RabbitMQ, which supports this format, and you can achieve some things through that. So, and another is kind of, I don't know actually what that format is, but but again. So what's important about these things is that they are actually working very fast in terms of they're very scalable, and they can process millions of events per second, meaning that they will help you, let's say, to build your solution when you have, let's say, tens of thousands of devices in market, and they probably can, let's say, work with that and will be able to handle that load you have and not to, you need to change your architecture or stuff like that. So, and also, they have very low latency. So, meaning that all the things which are running through them are happening very fast, and then they, let's say, you can get very instant results, which helps, let's say, for you to build very advanced solutions. And yeah, so they're reliable, something like that. And regarding the familiar tools, I guess if you want to, let's say, analyze a lot of data, SQL is, query language is kind of thing we kind of know. Kind of know, because I'm not SQL developer, so I kind of know I can write SQL, but I doubt that it will help to save the world if the problem arises with SQL code. But let's say I can write some queries and I understand how to read them. And I guess this is the most case with most developers who are not exactly writing SQL. Are not dedicated persons for that. So this is, let's say, some architectural drawing, let's say, how you can interact and get data from your devices. So you can, your device sends these data to website or directly to Event Hub, and then they are processed from Event Hub by Stream Analytics and then saved in some storages, or you have, there's, let's say, done some kind of indicators or calculated and stuff like that here, and you save that result here. Regarding the kind of things we are building here is that when we are having this, let's say, some highly scalable or fast components, please don't write and put your own stuff here in the middle, because if, let's say, can, I would say that I for sure cannot auto box write solution, which is also, let's say, highly scalable, low latency, and so on. So if I write something on my own here, it definitely will, let's say, start to mess the process up. So let's try to find a way how to process data either in real time now, or do later batch post-processing after these things, if we have, let's say, some of our very unique specific need, what we need to do and achieve. So regarding how does, okay, the guys in that side will not see. How does JavaScript looks for, let's say, sending data to Event Hub? Very simple. We just, let's say, define a client with some properties, keys, timeouts, and the connections, let's say, connection data. And then we create a message, which is some JavaScript object, and then we just send this, let's say, to our Event Hub thing. And this is a code you can actually have running on your Internet of Things devices. If, for example, you have this device and it is able to run, I don't know, Node.js code, so then you can plug this library in and then send this data over the net to achieve these things. So, for example, if you have Raspberry Pi as your main device, which is recommendation from our side, that you use, let's say, I don't know, some cheap Arduino devices as telemetry sensory input dates, and then you have this one central device, let's say, for, I don't know, home automation, which is Raspberry, and which gathers data and maybe do some purposing on-site, and then you can send it, let's say, to cloud through that. So in Stream Analytics, this is, let's say, the statements and code you can kind of not see. So as the guys there can see, arrows here, select device ID, blah, blah, blah. Then from this Event Hub node, and you input into, let's say, this blob storage, which is just blob storage name, code name. So let's say it's very hard thing to, let's say, learn in terms of, you know, SQL, and there's, let's say, nothing new. Much. Another things you can do with Stream Analytics, for example, you can, let's say, do some, let's say, transformations and filtering and so on, which is shown here in this SQL, let's say, kind of example, how you can, let's say, save data you are getting from devices. Because the first thing which we get usually is that when you're building some solution, device is, let's say, sending this data in, let's say, some unstructured format, and we want to give it some meaning, so we need, let's say, to clean the data out, or put them into, let's say, some columns or something like that, so that we can do this processing, if we want. Of course, if we don't want, we can just save it to some NoSQL database and be happy with that. And yeah, and then we created all these, let's say, transformations, and also create some alerts if needed, if there's some problems. And then we can send these data. And all these queries, let's say, will run actually really fast there. So let's say you can write out of them if you need to have stuff like that. So yeah, but as I said, start small with the telemetry. So that, let's say, you don't overkill yourself with thinking about some commands, which in the end are not useless, but no one cares about them, and they are not needed. So we don't waste time on things which are not relevant. And also, it's really straightforward for us to get code running and port type deployed if we have just telemetry without commands, because it adds, let's say, another layer of complexity. So yeah. Yeah, as I said earlier, don't put some, I don't know, mess up with the execution flow. In terms, if you have some scalable components, then don't add your code in the middle, so that it messes up with things and makes life harder. Another important thing is regarding which kind of I will not dwell very deep into, but is that when we are building our software, also in Internet of Things, we are given great responsibility to your users, customers, and so on in terms of their data, because we are getting a lot of, let's say, private information from them. And when we are creating software, we need to have, let's say, very strict requirement. So that we are not misusing that or allowing anyone else to steal our users' data and do some stuff with that, because again, it's trust. And regarding that, let's say main hint from our side, kind of I checked out some, let's say, guidance from one architect in Microsoft, and he wrote that to achieve that. We need to know a lot about all networks we are using, and let's say to trust, kind of not trust, in a sense, not trust whatever data we are sending over the network, and hopefully try to, let's say, encrypt anything which goes between, let's say, two points and so on. So, but it also, it's a problem from other side is that when we are using these very cheap devices, sometimes they don't have power to achieve, let's say, these encryptions and so on in real time. So it's, we need somehow to find a balance between these things. Or maybe then send the data in format which is, let's say, not hackable easy, because everything is hackable at the end of the day. Another thing is, which is not, let's say, out in the market, but it will come out, is that Microsoft will build, let's say, Internet of Things suite for all, let's say, these backend scenarios, and it will be, let's say, one shop, one place shop, if you want to, let's say, to have this kind of solution for whatever problem you have, and with all the components you need there, and you will be able, let's say, to use that and grow, let's say, easy and this one, let's say, central place. Because right now there's a, let's say, a lot of different these services, as I said, but in the end they can actually speak to each other and so on, but there's no, let's say, very easy and convenient way to, let's say, get the big picture and overview of how you're using that. So this thing is coming out. And in order to use that, here is a reference architecture which we are kind of providing that, kind of, if you try to follow that, then your solutions kind of should be easily migrated to that and so on. So first thing is, yeah, first we have these different devices here, then we have some transport and secure gateways to which we can send some kind of things to, let's say, cloud. And in cloud we have another, let's say, security level, so that, let's say, nothing happens when the data enters there, so that no one can access them and do some stuff there. So what next things happen, we process data, we end then we can do some presentations, or we can also give some feedback back to our devices and send some commands automatically from there, and change, let's say, the look of that. And yes, as I said, you just, let's say, need to kind of, in terms of the solutions you can use, let's say, this is the way how we imagine that it could make sense and it could, let's say, make life easier for you as developers for Internet of Things. Regarding companies who have done some things there, there is a bunch of, let's say, power plants, no, but let's say manufacturing companies. Fujitsu, I think, in Japan, created their manufacturing process monitoring solution using these things. So, and this allows them, let's say, to be faster in terms of delivering value to their customers. So then added some segment about, let's say, standard scenarios that we can do, let's say, when we are processing some data in with the Internet of Things, and then there is a bunch of more code. There is, let's say, standard this kind of drawing as we saw earlier about how we are processing data and everything is happening. Kind of, because it's, let's say, I think this is the third time I'm showing the same, let's say, this kind of overview picture, but in different, let's say, graphics. And then when we do that, we can use, let's say, the stream analytics and how kind of it can help us. So it's As I said, it's kind of fast and it's low latency, and it can, let's say, speak to all levels of different services and process, put data there, take data from them and so on. That's one thing. And we can control it and have some auditing inside and so on. But, and it's kind of fast for us because we kind of know SQL. So we can write also, let's say, in that language and achieve some, let's say, very complex logics there, put there. So let's say, so we do some data transformations and so on, which maybe is the reason thing for which we, let's say, would like to have this our own component in middle. So we can use that one. So this one. And it allows us, let's say, not to care about these things. Like we don't need to create our solution, let's say, from zero. We already have all these things built for us. Like how to integrate with different solutions, which are, let's say, available in this cloud platform. How to manage infrastructure failures, how to manage, let's say, all of these, let's say, painful things. And yeah. So we just get things faster. And this is as a full extent of SQL this SQL analytical query language is a vote, and let's say what kind of functions you can have and what kind of structures you can use in order, let's say, to make your life easier. What's interesting here is that you can also, in order when you reach bigger scale, you can split your, let's say, code between different execution, let's say, physical places and physical, let's say, streaming processing engines, instance of them, using windowing. So that's one thing, and for example, to show that, we can do, let's say, some Twitter data analysis, and here I will just show, let's say, example of this query language, how you can achieve, let's say, some result. So here is, let's say, the input data we are getting, which is, let's say, we have this column with date, name, time zone, some text, language, topic, and so on. It's, let's say, we are getting all these things from some sentiment analysis software. So, what we can do, we can do some filtering, let's say, by time, place, topic, and we can, let's say, that, let's say, select username, time zone from the stream where topic is, let's say, Xbox, and then we can see this data only, let's say. What we can do next is that we can check out, let's say, during the time and different instances which we are getting. So over the time we can actually put all these things together in some groups. So for example, if you want to, let's say, group things which are happening, let's say, between some 15 minute time frame window, then we can group them, let's say, in time, which is kind of a really cool thing because kind of usually, let's say, at least I don't know how in SQL I can write that for some data, unless I have some, let's say, distinct data thing happening. So, but this is, let's say, in regarding, let's say, real time data we are getting there. And so it will add also some timestamp for, let's say, all things which are happening to achieve that. So we also can have these windows which are a bit overlapping. And we can check, let's say, if hell, I lost my thought. So these are, let's say, 10-second hopping windows. So this area, yeah. And then with 5-second hops, which means that yeah. So some of these data is the same and processed, let's say, in parallel and grouped together. So, because as we can see, it's number 4, 6 is 2 is here, and then it's also processed in this window, then there's another one, the guys coming, we process them in next, and then we process them together with these guys, and so on. So it, let's say, allows us to group data, let's say, together, and maybe do some more, let's say, smarter decisions, make. Let's say take into account also some things which are happening in the past and so on, so that we are smarter in our solution, which is kind of actually fairly cool hack. We can also join multiple streams coming from, let's say, different input devices or places. In this example, there's, let's say, it's the same stream, but generally we can join them and get even more better analytics and insights. So, for example, if you have one kind of sensor sending one kind of data and another one sending another kind of data, if there's, let's say, some parameters which are the same, like, I don't know, time or something, then, here's also this field match, but in general. And then we can, let's say, create something more interesting and cooler out of that. So, and so we can also, let's say, do some, I don't know, joins. So that's one thing. We can then save all this data, let's say, in some files, in some storage, and then we can let's say connect them, and also we can send them also to another services, like, for example, we can send them also to machine learning, but I will come to that later. So regarding this, we can when we are growing big, we are having, let's say, event hubs are scaling through some traditional, let's say, and meaning that we can also, let's say, add all these different partitions here, as we can have in SQL, and let's say analyze data well through that. So that's one. And and we can also, let's say, write not just one function query, but we can write actually also a lot of different things which provide some semi-output in the middle and how to achieve that. So in the end, actually, I would like to show you one thing which is kind of when we are creating our Internet of Things solution. So first thing is we are getting this telemetry data. Then when we are, let's say, processing them, it's kind of working. Then we send, let's say, this data, I don't know, for some more users, let's say, to do some things, maybe do some analytics and so on. But sometimes we want the system to respond faster. So how we can, let's say, set that the respondent sends back these commands to end users. So, and how to make these smart decisions. So we can use machine learning. And I will try now if my internet connection is working, actually to open Azure Machine Learning Studio. I created there some sample workspace. Hopefully it will start to work. So, and here is, let's say, the how machine learning solution looks, let's say, in Azure Machine Learning platform. So, regarding that, all the ones who have, let's say, studied that a bit will know for sure that in order to do machine learning or whatever, data mining, first thing you need to do is, let's say, when you're getting these data, you need to, let's say, clean them out of some missing data or whatever, because usually data are, okay, they're always messy, there could be some kind of bad messages or whatever. Then another thing is we need here, we can project, let's say, these values to some columns, and so that, let's say, this studio knows what to do with that, and how to classify this data. And after that, we need, let's say, to split, let's say, if we are, let's say, training our algorithms, then we need to split, let's say, incoming data sets into, let's say, two parts, one which is for training with the algorithm, another one is, let's say, for testing against, testing, let's say, already what it learned, and seeing if it's kind of smart enough to make good decisions, let's say, but that's, let's say, in our learning environment. And then to decide kind of if it's predicting things correctly or not. So we need to have at least these two data sets. So here is some Certainly, whatever we are doing here is, so let's go here. First is we are getting, this is simple workflows where we with drag and drop we are just adding these components on the side, and then if we want, let's say, to do some more logic which is not built in here, we can execute Python or add language scripts to, let's say, to do, let's say, analysis on top of that. And after that, we can also do some, I don't know, some different operations which are built in here. How to make it so, and then okay, so then okay, I lost. Okay, so after that, let's say we are doing some, there's some page processing here. So then we are just projecting columns, which means that we have this data incoming in unformatted format, whatever, or maybe in some JSON, whatever. And then we are just projecting all the fields we are having the, as, let's say, as kind of table view. Then we are also cleaning from missing values, then executing some logic script, and in the end, because there is already built in some these algorithms for, let's say, basic things we can do, like, okay, let's try to go, make it, so let's save it, and, cool, and then we can also, let's say, add some, I don't know, machine learning constraints, like training the model and do analysis on top of that. Like, for example, we can do the score, we can transform it, and we can train it to do some things, like train anomaly detections and so on. And there is also a possibility, let's say, to have these different algorithms which are built on, so that was here. No. Initialize model. Yes. So in initial, there's, let's say, built-in algorithms which are pretty much standard in data mining sense and also in machine learning for decision trees, some boosted decision trees, called clustering algorithms, and regression analysis. Which we can do, and we can add all these components here in the end and send out this data. But the coolest thing is about machine learning service that it works in a manner that when we are done, let's say, with modeling and testing our solution, we can actually, let's say, publish it as a web service, and we can set, let's say, this input field where we are sending in data, and then we are, also can set, let's say, this output endpoint REST web service where we are, let's say, saving and data into whatever storage. We're giving some feedback back to users so that we can incorporate it fully into our solution in that sense. And things which could save you a lot of time is that you can, first is you can create your solution fully, or you can create, let's say, only, let's say, maybe either a brain part, like machine learning, then you can actually expose APIs you created and sell them for some amount of money. Or another thing is you want to be a bit lazier and you don't, let's say, know, you are not a data scientist, essentially. Then you can actually buy from data scientists who built some machine learning services and integrate that into your solutions. So, or get them for free in some cases. Also, there's a bunch of these APIs which were built by Microsoft, and they're free for you to use. For example, the one which recognizes, let's say, for pictures, your face and gives you your age, which is actually fairly imprecise, but there's, let's say, different these kind of store options you can get. Also, there's another one for which, let's say, you can categorize images and get, let's say, which images are having flowers, which are showing children or whatever. And another, let's say, APIs you can use in your let's say for buildings is business things. And and coolest part is that anyone can publish their solutions here, and you can use them. For example, there is some tutorials and whatever, built one for sensor data analytics, and thing, let's say, taking out, let's say, the data which are invalid and messes up with the, let's say, time and life and so on. So this is just to briefly go over these things. So yeah, we can, let's say, set up all this stuff from Azure Management Portal. So one is here, and for stream analytics, which is a place where we are getting, we can add inputs, create some queries, and define, let's say, places where we are storing the data and so on. Regarding the machine learning, there's the issue. What we have now is that, I guess, so how many of you are concerned about in which countries your data are stored? Okay, three people, five, six. Where do you think Microsoft has data centers? So yes, it has in Ireland, in Europe it has in Ireland, and also in Amsterdam. And maybe it will have something in Finland, but I don't know. But the issue is that if we have data stored in Europe, then they are protected by European laws. Meaning it's, let's say, it's private data, no one can access them, blah, 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 and so on. But if you send this data over the sea to the United States, then let's say if you are afraid of American government and they explicitly know that you did something, they can go to Microsoft and say, I know you know this guy from Latvia did some stuff, and I would like to check out what he is storing with there. Then they may give kind of, we may not have a choice on the matter. So, regarding that, machine learning service right now is available in the United States, meaning that it will only, but during the summer, it will come also to Europe. So, meaning that if you are planning to build some kind of data processing on top of that, you can now, let's say, play around if you care about this thing. And if you, I don't know, don't care so much and have nothing, let's say, to be afraid of, then you can use also it in the United States. So, but that's, let's say, thing. Also, it means that in terms of getting the data, as we all want to process the data very fast, we need, let's say, to have all these things, let's say, in vicinity, in terms that we can use data centers which are closer to us, which could make sense for us, or in our case. So it could be your. But generally, per se, we don't actually care what kind of data you have. We don't look at them and so on. We even don't know for, let's say, which some machines which are running there. From our side, we even don't know how much memory is used by you. So it means that, let's say, we can get only, let's say, deeper level of access to your systems only if you explicitly ask us to do that. Otherwise, we are not going, let's say, we cannot access them. So, what else? So, as I have about 30 seconds, you can ask me one question or more.
No, we actually have time for questions after this.
Okay.
So.
So as I understood, all the infrastructure for handling the data is in the data center, mm-hmm. the Azure Cloud. So does it mean that we need to constantly upload gigabytes of data from our home devices to the cloud to get them analyzed?
And in that case, yes. Yeah.
So does it mean we need a constant and very good connection to these servers?
Depends kind of what are, kind of, if you have, let's say, this resolution spread it out to different houses and so on, meaning kind of, not necessarily.
But you how much of that can be processed at home, I mean, in these intermediate centers, if you have many homes to manage?
You mean like in locally?
Yeah.
So on your devices. So it depends a lot on what kind of device you have. Kind of, if you have this solution built with some adult Raspberry Pi, you get, let's say, performance of so Raspberry Pi right now is 1 gigabyte or what gigahertz? I mean, in terms of processor, what? It's more powerful.
Something like that.
Yes. Yeah, so, so you get, let's say, that amount of power. So, if you want, let's say, to do some more in-depth analysis, and the power of Internet of Things actually more comes that you have data, not only from, let's say, one location, but let's say from tons of locations, so that you can, let's say, see some patterns emerging from these tons of data you're getting to this one place from, let's say, different homes and so on. So then you can, let's say, make smarter decisions, and then machine learning makes sense in one case. Another case is, for example, if you have more powerful devices. I don't know, for example, there was one case study about they built a kiosk which had Kinect device in front of it, and they used, let's say, Kinect, and also together with some backend stuff in the cloud, they used that to, let's say, in a shop that users were going around, and they tried to, let's say, from seeing the user's face and the way how they moved, to guess what would be interesting to them. And they possess some images of user, let's say, to a cloud service, but through Kinect they, let's say, got all the body features and so on, and then they, let's say, try very fast to show something to users back to them. So if you have more powerful device, you can process way more, because Kinect kind of it detects your, by mapping, it detects your body, let's say, outline, and gives you 3D vector coordinates of your, let's say, joints and stuff like that.
What kind of device you support? Or it's like you give only API and I make my, okay.
Yeah. So, meaning in terms of devices, you can use whatever which connects to internet and supports, let's say, HTTP or TCP.
So, generally, I make my own device.
So, if it connects to internet, then we don't care. Okay, no one cares.
Okay.
So, you need to have internet capability.
Okay.
Hi. A question about performance. Are we assuming here real-time analytics? What I mean, SQL database and...
It's not SCADIS, it's not SQL. No. It has SQL-like syntaxes.
Ah, so it's not a SQL.
It's not SQL.
And on your slide, there was approximately 1 gigabyte per second of data collecting.
Yeah.
An example. And when we are talking, okay, here we can mention big data and so on.
Yeah.
But what is, okay, in other words, what is the bottleneck? Database or in performance?
So I guess it depends on which specific scenario. Bottleneck could be, I guess, in general, it always could be, it would be input-output operations, meaning it could be, I don't know, some network, and then saving the data to some local storage. It will be the lowest things you can do. Whatever the solution is, it will be the lowest places, because as long as we are processing it and keeping it kind of in memory or some cache which is in memory and so on, so it will be fast. So stream analytics is working in the sense that it tries to store most of its data in to this, let's say, RAM memory, and which is fastly accessible to us. And then by default it does not store anything, because it just processes all the data which are coming into some windows, the window frames, and putting them into other locations and so on.
Actually, honestly, I'm pushing you to the database more close.
Yeah.
I'm guessing that this is somehow you showed a lot of different scenarios, mm-hmm. like analytics. It's a complex,
yeah.
And it takes time, definitely.
Yeah.
And this, I guess, could be so the place when you need, for example, real-time analytics,
mm-hmm.
for prediction or something,
yes.
like that.
Yeah, so, I mean, these companies are built that way, that they try to scale, but, and then when they're getting it, let's say, is it, let's say, to maximum throughput, I don't know if it's, and I didn't, let's say, test it myself, if it's this 1 gigabyte per second or 1 terabyte or whatever, and when you're getting to the maximum layers, and what it happens, I guess, it spins some another instances, and then you can, let's say, this, and it scales through, let's say, at this at that level through some vertical, no, horizontal scaling.
And if I have time for another question, it's not a SQL database, but the language just similar to single syntax,
yes.
And
yeah.
That's all.
Yeah.
It's like no SQL database.
Yeah. So it's not database, it's processing engine. Stream Analytics is processing engine, so there's no database, it has syntaxes of SQL-like. But when you are processing and saving, let's say, this data, you can save them at some NoSQL database, I don't know, in MongoDB, in DocumentDB, or whatever, whatever, or cluster pointer, if you would like.
Thanks.
Any other questions? I think we have time for one more. Okay, so thank you, Aigars, and we'll have a short...